We're pleased to be joined by the mayor of the city of Baltimore, Baltimore City Mayor Brandon Scott, and we have a chance to talk with him on a regular basis. Good morning, Mr. Mayor.
Hey, Mr. Mayor.
Good morning, gentlemen. I was excited. I thought we were going to be in person today.
We were, too. So we got to catch up with your wonderful
next month, we hope.
Face. Yeah, exactly, when we get to see you next month. But, Mr. Mayor, we are having on the program next week on our show the special agent in charge of the FBI, Thomas Subasinski, on next week to talk about a lot of things, but most importantly, the rise in carjackings. There was a tweet.
Yes, sir.
There was a tweet that you retweeted yesterday from the FBI talking about the DEA, ATF, all Baltimore City Police were all involved, Baltimore County Police, in combating the recent carjackings. Tell us, Mr. Mayor, we have a 69% increase in carjackings. What are we doing about this?
Yeah, listen, this is something that we know is a problem, and the FBI knows is a problem, all our federal problems, for not just the city, but the surrounding counties, but really across the country, C4, there's this big rise in this. So when you have the partners and you work with them to investigate, to try to close these, what we call rings of folks who are out committing these carjackings, going from place to place in the city, county, of course, ignoring jurisdictional lines because they don't matter to folks who are doing criminal activities. This is why we have to have those relationships with our federal partners. As you know, they have the best resources, the best technology, working hand in hand with them to close these cases and hopefully then turning those folks over to other parts of the justice system so that they don't consistently get back out. You heard this the last time. I'll say it again. I, through my police staff process, had the police department go and search the data, and we went and got the data, and my folks and my data team, OPI, and saw that such a high percentage of the folks that we were arresting, young people we were arresting for carjacking, were rearrest for similar things, and most of them within the last year, right? Mm. That's something that we should not see. And it speaks again to something that C4 and Bryan, the three of us, talk about consistently, about changes we need to make after the arrest to the system. And that's something that we have to discuss continuously.
So they carjack less than a year later, they carjack again, and you catch the same people, and they're all
well, not just carjacking, Brian, let me be clear. It could be we arrested them for a carjacking and we arrest them for robbery, or robbery before and the carjacking. So seeing them for similar crimes consistently over and over again.
Do you know, you talk about the FBI and needing their help in all of this. Is this happening just for like joyriding, just for fun? Or are they doing something with these cars? I mean, what is going on?
Yeah, it depends. I will say this too, though, Brian. I think it's important for folks to know this. One of the things, like for a joyriding thing, because you brought that up, we know that, you know, young people for forever, you know, took cars and were joyriding. But I think it's important for folks to hear this. One of the reasons why folks believe that this is carjacks are increasing, even for young people that are joyriding, you can't just steal a new car. You need the key fob. Mm-hmm. You have to actually physically have that. And you can see that reflected in the data, because cars that are newer are the ones that are being carjacked and not the older ones percentage-wise. But sometimes this is about joyriding. Sometimes it's about taking that car to use and do other criminal activity, robberies and things like that. Nothing is the same. No groups are alike. And I think it's important too, Brian and C4, to know, normally, you know, when in C4 and I's Baltimore growing up, folks operated in these kind of networks based on their neighborhood and where they live, right? That's not the case. You see these folks who are involved in one group can be involved with another group on another side of town. There's connectivity through social media and other things. And that's why you have to have this robust partnership that goes beyond jurisdictional bounds, working with multiple partners, because these groups are working in all areas of our region.
Baltimore City Mayor Brandon Scott is on board with us. And Mayor, back in January, you and State Senator Corey McCrae at different times came on our show, chairman of the Senate delegation, talking about how you were going to get either the judges to join you at the Criminal Justice Coordinating Council or somehow have more cooperation about what happens after the arrest. We're sitting here in May. Where in the CJCC are we in terms of figuring out what's happening after the arrest?
Yeah, so I think right now, actually, we're in a much better place than we were in January C4. I'm going to say again and say it publicly. The partners that are at the table have been great. The governor having the state folks back at the table. So parole and probation, corrections, DJS, DSS, and that all of those folks at the table have been fantastic. And it's about the staff people, not about the governor, not about myself, not about the state's attorney, about the people doing the work. And what we have been able to do now is start to peel back some of these issues. And some of them, you know, because they led to us having conversations in Annapolis about particular issues of notification and what's happening after arrest and building those systems. And now that we have that law passed, we'll be able to see that notification and improve that coordination. But we know we have to go even further. Then one of the things that we're working on right now, CJCC, that's critically important to me, is that we want to create a public dashboard so that the residents of Baltimore and everywhere else can see what's happening all the way through. We're going to be doing that so that we're publicly sharing the information and data out. But we're not going to stop there, C4, because we talk about other issues before, and we're going to make sure that we start to try to address them now. And then, of course, when we get a new administration in Annapolis, like these issues around home monitoring, the fact that, you know, we learned through this process, and I actually told the governor, informed him of this, that folks can be, for example, on home monitoring for carjacking or robbery, will set aside for now whether someone should even be on home monitoring for that, but they do. But that person can then be outside of their geofencing for 24 hours before the folks are able to go and do their work, right? And then go even further. If you're outside of your geocoding and we know you're not supposed to be there and you're for this violent crime or whatever you have, it then requires still parole and probation to go get a warrant. And then the law enforcement side can take action. Those are the kind of gaps that we have to close so that, as you know, we're not finding people dead with ankle monitors.
So real quick, I want our audience to be clear on this, Mr. Mayor. You're saying that what you're being informed of, and Brian, that they could be outside of their perimeter for 24 hours before there's a notification?
But before there's like action and things that can be taken. Yes, sir. I know it was incredible to me. It was incredible to the governor. I remember the look on his face when I said it to him. It's just about systems change that needs to happen to support the folks at parole and probation, because it's about if I'm a citizen of this state, right? If when someone tells me that someone is being monitored in 2022, that means that it's instant.
Right.
If
exactly.
That person breaks it, it should be instant. But that's not where we are just yet. And my commitment really too is not point fingers at anybody, but then to now work with the folks at the state and others to say, okay, how can we improve this system?
Mr. Mayor, I got a big picture question, and obviously we have the Preakness coming up. You know, we're trying to get the All-Star Game for Major League Baseball. We're trying to get the World Cup here. We're a great tourist town, great visitor town. And here we are, we've got murders up, we've got shootings up, we've got carjackings up. The squeegee kids have not changed at all. It's the same. They're deemed to be a nuisance by a lot of people. Do you look at this as that we've hit a tipping point where people are avoiding coming to Baltimore? Are you worried about that it's going to hurt us from getting some of those big events and people are going to just continue to leave the city?
No. What I think is that, Brian, what we have now is we have issues that we've always had, right? And I can see, and I think folks are, for example, we consistently are having great events. We know, unfortunately, we had an incident outside the Hippodrome the other day. Mm-hmm. I was actually there the night before with a sold-out crowd with the biggest Temptations fan I know, my dad, right?
My mom.
And then, C4, and then yesterday, after that, they still had a sold-out crowd. People want to be in the city. They want to come to the city. It's just up to us to make sure that we are handling and attacking these issues in every way, right? Consistently. We know that the Orioles, our good friends at the Orioles, not only want to bring the All-Star game, but to bring more concerts and things. And they are not going to be deterred from that. Folks like the great folks at the Hippodrome are not going to be deterred. I was down in Canton last night, first Thursday, where 10,000 people came out. People are committed to Baltimore, and I am committed, Brian, to making sure that we work with whoever we have to do, who work with to handle these issues once and for all. No one's expecting them to go away. You're not expecting them to go away overnight, but people are looking for folks who are dedicated in doing that work. And when you see, and when you see the work that our detectives are doing, the way that they are closing these cases, that message is going to start to get to folks. But we also have to understand, Brian, the difference. Again, the difference in the stuff that is happening today as well.
But they're not seeing it, though. They're not seeing the difference. I mean, we're on pace for 1,000 shootings by the end of the year. We've got on pace for 600 carjackings. Like I said, the squeegee kids. I see people literally run red lights and do whatever they can to avoid the squeegee kids. That happens every single day in this
town.
Right,
Brian. No, I was talking about the difference in how the incidents are happening and why, but also the difference in the approach. And if folks, again, it's up to all folks like you and I to tell folks about that, right? The same way that we talk about the incidents that happen, we should be talking with that same vigor about how many guns the police department has taken off the street, how often someone who commits that crime, for example, we had a gentleman, loose term, that committed a murder on May the 4th. You know what? He was arrested on May the 4th for that homicide, right? That's the kind of thing that we have to talk about as well. And even when you're talking about the squeegee, right, we need to be talking about how there are hundreds of them that we've taken off the street through our program, and we're looking to work with businesses to do even more of that consistently. And even when you think about where we are with the violence and making sure that we are going to be pushing those things down by working with our federal partners, with our state partners, with our community partners, everybody has to be involved in it. Because again, Brian, this is something that has plagued Baltimore for a long time, that it's also plaguing the country at this moment for a variety of reasons.
Baltimore City Mayor Brandon Scott is on board with us. And Mr. Mayor, when it comes to, back to the Criminal Justice Coordinating Council for a moment, the issue of the district court judges representing themselves, the circuit court judges representing themselves, the state's attorney's office, what can you tell us about what they're telling you or at least communicating with you? Because I understand you're saying, you know, it might be a little better, but without the input of the prosecutors and judges, we don't know what's going on.
Well, the state attorney's office is at the table, so they're there. They're there. They're communicating. They're participating fully, just like the state and our federal partners. The judges, we are still working to try to convince them to come back to the table. You know, I'm going to continue to do that, and if they don't, we will do what we have to do
but
in another way. Right?
I'm just telling you from experience from being on this commission, this Criminal Justice Coordinating Council, you can't be effective without them. They're critical to figuring out what's happening.
You know, normally I don't disagree with you, C4, but I would disagree a little bit. In this day and age, especially when you have everyone else at the table and everyone else lockstep on how these things are moving and need to move. For example, as you know, this piece of legislation that we got passed about a simple thing that every other jurisdiction in the state
has, the notification,
right? They did not want that to happen. It happened anyway because everyone else was saying, okay, we hear what you guys are saying, but you're not even at the table. You're refusing to come and talk to these folks. They're coming with a simple solution. So if they don't come, they're still going to be there. You're going to see folks driving things either through the legislature or through executive change that are going to force folks to play ball and work together. And, you know, no disrespect to your CJCC, but the one prior to this, it didn't work that well with them at the table either because they were running it and we essentially ran it into the ground is what happened.
Yeah. Mr. Mayor, you know, I would never doubt your love of Baltimore, your commitment. Every time there's a major event, you are there and you're one of the first people there. No matter what time of morning it is, you have shown your commitment before you were mayor to these things as well and to try to make Baltimore safe. But do you really think that things are getting better? Because the numbers don't say that they're getting better.
Well, so Brian, you and I could talk about numbers in many different ways, right? I could tell you that when you and I talked in February, when I was on you guys' show in February, we were at a rate where we had a 30% increase in homicides, and now it's down to like 6 or 7, right? So I could talk to you about that. But the reality is that we know that it's still too many. But what you see in the city each and every day, when you're not talking about these events, you see people coming, you see people being a part of, you see community members like I saw yesterday when I talked to them out on the scene, right, who says, look, folks are working in this neighborhood. We're not going to tolerate this. This is not the kind of thing that happens. We're not going to be dismayed. I was talking to a business owner who said, I'm not going anywhere because I'm not letting these folks take over my community. That's the thing that keeps me going, Brian, how I see a difference coming. But it's also up to us to challenge folks in a different way, Brian. Challenge people to think about gun violence in a different way. For example, I've talked to you guys ad nauseum about, like, people, this is different. Folks are doing things more brazenly. They don't care.
Right.
It's personal, right? It's different than it was before.
They're attacking police officers.
Exactly. So the solutions that we have to be updated, and we have to attack things in multiple ways. And I know we're running short on time, but we have to do that as well, Brian, because when you see police officers getting carjacked, right? And clearly, right? And when you think about that, it's not even just that. It's again about the fact that these things are happening all over. Folks don't care about jurisdictional bounds. And in that case, as you know, because they said it publicly, neither of those gentlemen resided in the city. Folks are just out here doing things and are really aloof on who they're even doing it to. And we could talk for hours and hours about that. It's about us attacking that. It's about us fixing those systems that allow, as C4 was saying, for us to see the same people over and over again. That's what we have to do. And stop just getting to this point where folks just want to point the fingers at the police or point the fingers at Safe Tree, or point the finger at this person. Let's just say that everybody involved in it has to be better, because that's the truth.
Finally, Mr. Mayor, we appreciate Baltimore City Mayor Brandon Scott being on board. Something we've been talking about for 20 years that we're finally looking like we're getting underway today. You're going to be having input from folks in reference to redistricting the 9 police districts, because then we're not able to really do what we need to do with these 9 districts. Commissioner Harrison, Monsey Director Shantae Jackson. Why is this important that we change these 9 police districts, the boundaries?
Yeah, I mean, the truth is that, to your point, even from a policing standpoint, right, that's why I always say we have to update and evolve. We haven't changed our police district significantly since 1959, C4. That was the year my dad was born. The Northeast District, in which I reside, as you know, makes up 17 square miles of a 90 square mile city. And when you are policing on outdated population data, outdated crime data,
you can't be effective.
You can't be effective. So changing these districts to make them meet the needs of not just the volume of people, the call volume, high priority calls, all of that, community relationships, boundaries, hard boundaries, so that folks aren't policing 2 sides of a body or water or 2 sides of a park that make it hard, so that we can effectively and efficiently do the patrol work that we need to do. And this is another portion of this reimagining policing. This is something that we have to do. As you know, I've been talking about this my entire elected life, and we were finally able to, with my good friend and brother, Senator McCray, get this done. And now we're going to do it so that we consistently have to do it every 10 years like we do every other district, so we're always operating under the best optimization.
Mr. Mayor, Baltimore City Mayor Brandon Scott, I appreciate it. And, you know, I kind of feel your dad's pain. I was born in 62, so I'm right there. 59, 62,
yes,
right there. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, gentlemen. And hopefully I see y'all in person next month.
Yeah, we do too. Thank you always for your time. We appreciate it.
I appreciate it.